coming up on Pierce County News.
I'm very grateful for having them.
Victims of crime get help from Pierce County. A major exit to downtown Tacoma will close, and see a daffodil float come together. Hi, and welcome to Pierce County News. I'm Heather Radel. More than 13,000 crimes are committed in Pierce County every year, leaving a trail of victims to pick up the pieces. During National Crime Victims Week, we take a look at what Pierce County's Victim Witness Assistance Service is doing to help victims and their families find justice and healing.
Derek, how you been doing?
Derek Sanders will never forget the night his dad called with the terrible news.
And he immediately said, there's been a home invasion. The boys and Char are okay, but your brother's been murdered.
He was told that his brother, Jim Sanders, was murdered after placing an ad on Craigslist to sell a diamond ring. The killers, posed as potential buyers, tied the family up and murdered Jim right in front of his family.
Immediately, it was like a cinder block to the face because you're just in immediate shock.
Derek raced to his brother's home, where a Pierce County chaplain was there to greet him.
I believe it was the very next morning that victims advocates reached out to us and let us know that they were a resource for us.
For the next year and a half, victims advocates from the Pierce County Prosecutor's Victim Witness Service Program worked closely with the Sanders family.
We spend a lot of time, especially at the onset of a case, explaining the criminal justice process, because we understand as advocates that it's going to be very traumatic for them to be exposed to the criminal justice process.
Pierce County has the largest victim-based program in the state, with 16 advocates helping thousands of victims recover from everything from sexual assault and robbery to identity theft and murder.
There are hundreds of Sanders families out there, if you will. They deal with this every day. Somebody that is dealing with this loss, dealing with the trials, dealing with everything that we go through. They deal with it all the time, but honestly, we felt like we were the only ones that they had to work with.
Sanders says not a day goes by that he doesn't think about his brother, and that he can't imagine going through this tragedy without the Pierce County Victim Assistance Advocates.
Family. So our prosecutors and Wayne and his staff have become a part of our family.
For more information on the services Pierce County offers for victims and their families, go to pierceprosecutor.org. There is a major freeway exit closure coming that could impact many drivers coming to downtown Tacoma. It's important to know the detour route for the city center exit off I-5. Starting Saturday, April 28th, the Washington State Department of Transportation will completely close the northbound I-5 exit 133 to the city center. The ramp will be demolished as part of the work being done on the eastbound Nalley Valley project.
The ramp that's there now was built as a temporary ramp, as well as the bridge that's being used. And it was always planned to be temporary. And now that we're where we're at in the HOV construction program, we have the ability to put the ramp where it needs to go in its ultimate configuration.
To get to the city center from the freeway, you'll have to take one exit earlier, exit 132, which most people know as the way to State Route 16. You'll want to stay in the right lane until you see the exit only sign for Seattle and downtown Tacoma. Merge to the right and take the exit to I-705 and City Center, which will drop you off at the same place exit 133 did.
We also are going to be doing some restriping work that will allow two lanes to exit to the city center from exit 132 so that there's more capacity, more lanes that will exit. So that should help with congestion. However, we still expect that during commute hours, if we don't get people to travel at different times or take alternate routes, that we still will see congestion.
A reconstructed exit 133 is expected to reopen in late July. The Pierce County Council unanimously approved permanent boating restrictions on Lake Taps and also passed a new no parking zone. 3 years ago, the County Council passed a temporary ordinance to see if it would stop boats from joining together and anchoring in Fairweather Cove. That location on the lake was notorious for parties, heavy drinking, and lewd behavior.
Prior to this being in place, it was hard to enjoy my own waterfront with my children due to the nature of the individuals that came out there with their music, beer bongs, urination. And since this has been in place, it's been a enjoyable place for us to go as a family.
Council members say those rules have worked and solved the problem, which is why they voted to make them permanent.
The fact is it is working. Whether you're pro or con on this, everyone agrees that this ordinance is working. And myself as a council member, I don't think it's smart to fix a problem that's literally taken years and years to fix and then open the door back up and allow it to recreate itself.
Another vote approved a no parking any time zone on the east side of Lake Taps. Drivers who park alongside the road in a 1/4 mile stretch between 213th Avenue and Island Parkway East could get a $25 ticket.
I think the $25 fee should be sufficient, and people will get that message that it is private property, it is a safety issue, and that it's not a place to park.
People have been causing safety concerns by parking along the road and illegally accessing the lake on private property by Dyke 12. If you have unused or expired medications, including controlled substances, it's important to get rid of them at a designated place in your community. There's a special take-back day coming up, and also permanent locations around Pierce County that will take them. Joining me today is Lieutenant Jim Kelly. He is with the Pierce County Sheriff's Department. Jim, what are the important reasons that people should get rid of unused or expired medications?
Well, there are three main reasons. The first one being the prescription drug abuse in this country is a big epidemic. And, you know, studies have shown that the majority of abused drugs come from within our own home, from our own medicine cabinets. So dispose of them properly helps prevent drug abuse from occurring. The second one is for to help prevent our children from getting a hold of them and, you know, overdoses or possibly dying from using these unused or unwanted drugs. And the third one is from preventing pollution to our water or into our environment, which occurs when we dump them down the toilet or throw them in the garbage. It's the best way is to dispose of them properly.
Okay, so when they are going to bring them in, how should they do that?
The best way for the viewers to do it is to leave it in the original container. And if they do that, I recommend that they either take the label off or black out the patient's name on the label. The other way they can do it is put the pills in a plastic baggie and bring the baggie in and put it in the collection bin.
Mm-hmm. Now, talking about collection bins, you are having a big event coming up on April 28th. Tell me about that.
April 28th is the fourth National Drug Takeback Day, which is sponsored by the Drug Enforcement Administration in conjunction with local law enforcement. It's Saturday, April 28th from 10 in the morning to 2 in the afternoon. Local law enforcement will be in various locations throughout the county during that day to collect unwanted or expired medication. The Sheriff's Department is sponsoring four sites, the first one being at the Sprinker Recreation Center parking lot, the Sheriff's South Hill Precinct at 160th Meridian, the University Place Police Department, and the Albertsons store located on Milton Way.
Okay, and I understand there are also, if for some reason they can't make it to that event, there are permanent locations. Where can people find out about those and more about the event?
The viewers can go to takebackyourmeds.org to get a complete list of the 23 permanent locations in Pierce County, as well as the temporary sites that will be set up on April 28th for the Drug Takeback Day. The Sheriff's Department sponsors three permanent locations, one being at the South Hill Precinct, the other at the University Place Police Station, and our third location is the Edgewood City Hall. Those are open throughout the year.
All right. Thank you so much, Lieutenant Kelly.
Thank you.
If you live next to a county right-of-way, you should know that road crews will start spraying herbicides and cutting brush this week through November. Workers will mow, cut brush, and trim trees along roads, and also spray weeds to control fire danger and improve stormwater drainage. If you want to maintain that right-of-way yourself, you need to sign an agreement with the county, which needs to be done each year. You'll also need to post a special sign in the right-of-way. You can get an application and sign at two locations, the Central Maintenance Facility in Frederickson or the West County Facility in Gig Harbor. Call or go online for more details. Pierce County celebrated the 79th annual Grand Floral Daffodil Parade this week. The parade traveled through Tacoma, Puyallup, Sumner, and Orting, where thousands of people lined the streets. The Daffodil Queen's float with 23 princesses is always a highlight, although it was sadly one princess short after the death of Princess Alexandria Cole, who was a senior at Chief Leschi High School.
They're here in a moment of deep tragedy. Today, the students of Chief Leschi are marching in honor of their princess, Alexandria Cole, who was the princess this year and passed away entering the spirit world on April 11th of this year.
The parade was complete with all the favorites, including daffodil-covered floats, high school marching bands, and collector cars. Coming up next, see what goes into building an award-winning parade float. We're back in just 60 seconds.
I vow to make excuses when you humiliate me in public, to forsake my friends and family when you isolate me, and to value myself less when you belittle me. I vow to blame myself when you hit me, and to fear for my safety and the safety of our children till death do us part.
Don't ignore domestic abuse. Speak now. The Family Justice Center is a place of safety.
So, I'm kind of new here, but I've noticed a trend. My human does this funny thing where she goes around and gets all my toys, and then she hides them in that basket by the door. You know, but it's always the same basket, and it's always in the same place. And then she acts so surprised when I find them, but, you know, she's putting them in the same basket again. It's like, hello, that's where you put it last time. You were the worst at hide and go seek.
Welcome back. We see a float go down the parade route for just a few minutes, but hundreds of hours go into creating each one. Megan Hutton takes us behind the scenes to the float barn, where Sumner's crew got to work early.
We're gonna fill the oasis rows with the rhubarb plants, and so we're cutting them off there.
For Lana Hoover, the pride she has for Sumner runs deep in her blood. She's lived there all her life. So combining her love of flowers with her small town has kept her coming back the last 10 years to decorate Sumner's daffodil float.
Because I love the parade, for one, and Sumner means a lot. So anything to help make it look good and make the float look good and represent our city is kind of important to me.
A small group of dedicated volunteers spend months planning, designing, and assembling the float to match a new parade theme each year.
We're trying to emphasize the theme of Sumner as a farming community, and its roots were in daffodils, and now it's a big rhubarb growing region.
Ben DeGody has helped oversee the float for 7 years. With local companies donating the flowers, the crew is busy the day before the daffodil parade, drilling, decorating, and placing flowers by hand.
Now there's so many people that help that aren't riding on the float or waving or standing next to it even during. They're sitting on the sides watching it just like us, but it takes a lot of people to put it together, so it's exciting.
The parade rules used to require at least 1,000 daffodils on each float, and Sumner still tries to honor that tradition.
Between 8,000 and 10,000 daffodils, probably 200-400 stalks of rhubarb, and probably another 3,000 or 4,000 or 5,000 assorted flowers and greens.
We have a lot of rhubarb farmers in town. We have a lot of bulb farmers, so we're trying to stick with that. As far as the other flowers, we ordered in things that are just native to the Northwest.
Hoover said it's watching her family's reaction to her float that makes the parade so exciting.
My kids know I'm here today, so they get excited when they see it go by, and of course they call it Mom's float.
It's obvious all that attention to detail caught the eye of Grand Floral Parade judges, too. Sumner's float won both the President's Award and the Festival Floral Award for the best use of fresh flowers. Megan Hutton, Pierce County News.
Up next, if you have a closet full of craft supplies you never use, here's your chance to sell some of it off or buy it up for cheap. But first, here are some dates for your calendar. If you're getting ready to do some spring cleaning, we've got the perfect place to get rid of your clutter. The City of Sumner's annual Shred and Clean event is Saturday, April 28th. People in Sumner can get rid of everything from light bulbs and batteries to household items, clothing, and paper that needs shredding. The event will be in the Red Apple parking lot in downtown Sumner from 10 in the morning until 2 in the afternoon. For more information, go to the city's website. Get out and enjoy the outdoors at the Gig Harbor Paddlers Cup and Expo April 28th and 29th. You'll see competitive paddle racing for kayaks, canoes, and stand-up paddle boards. The event will be held at Scancy Brothers Park in downtown Gig Harbor, with the first race kicking off at 9 a.m. For more information, go to gigharborpaddlerscup.com. This week, Kyle Wintermute has a plan to help all of those crafters out there. Hi, Kyle.
Hi, Heather. Hey, do you have that knick-knack, paddy-whack, rick-rack, crafty craft side to you? Well, if you do, then you should take advantage of the Crafters and Quilt Yard Sale this spring. This is an opportunity for you to shop for craft supplies at one location. So if you have a closet full of extra fabric, paper, ribbon, rickrack, threads, etc., then it's time to sort it all out and sell, sell, sell. Just think, after opening up all that space, you'll have room for even more crafting. Come get your new ideas at Frontier Park on Saturday, May 19th from 9 to 4. Call or go online for more information. If your child is feeling a little cooped up because of all this rain, we've got your solution. Tiny Tots Indoor Playground at Lakewood Community Center. It offers a fun and safe environment for your kids to socialize, run, jump, climb, and explore. Bring the whole neighborhood because we have oodles of toys and space for everyone. It happens on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 9:30 to 11. Call or go online for more information. Hey, if there's a recreation opportunity, then Pierce County Parks and Recreation is bound to craft up something for your enjoyment. I'm Kyle Wintermute for Pierce County News. Back to you, Heather.
Thanks, Kyle. You can see Pierce County from here on PCTV. We have the original programming you can't find anywhere else. For more local focus, watch a new episode of Rainier Country airing now, or watch it online anytime at piercecountytv.org. I'm Heather Radel. Thanks for watching Pierce County News.